Good afternoon, class. We are looking at section 2.2, limits of functions at infinity. So here's the synopsis of what we covered. A sequence is an ordered list of numbers or function f whose domain is the set of natural numbers. Limit refers to the long-term behavior of a sequence. So what happens in the long run if the limit exists, say a sub n converges to it. If it goes to infinity, negative infinity, d any means does not exist, the sequence diverges. To find limits, we simply plug in. We all remember this, where the limit of r to the power of n as n approaches infinity depends on the value of r. If it's between negative 1 and 1, not just 0 and 1, it goes to 0. If it's larger than 1, it goes to 1. This refers to the fact when the denominator gets larger and larger, the fraction gets smaller and smaller, getting closer to 0. This is a geometric sequence. When we add them up, it becomes a geometric series. Here's the sum. And when r is between negative 1 and 1, we get a over 1 minus r. Recursive solution for a geometric sequence, b sub n is b sub 0 r to the power of n, or remember sometimes we use a. In the case of a medication, when we add a constant, r is the percentage or portion that remains in the body, and C is the constant, and this is the solution for it, for B sub n. We're gonna start with section 2.2, limits of functions at infinity. So the definition of a horizontal asymptote simply is, when we take the limit of a function as x approaches negative or positive infinity, if we get to L, that is the horizontal asymptote. For example, we know this is zero, and therefore y equals zero would be the horizontal asymptote for the function 1 over x, or 1 over x to the power of p. This is an exponential decay because the base is between 0 and 1. For example, e to the power of negative x. When x goes to negative infinity, y goes to negative infinity. When x goes to positive infinity, y goes to zero. That's why we have this. And the limit of f of x as x approaches negative infinity is infinity. In this case, we have an exponential growth where the base is larger than one. When x goes to infinity, y goes to infinity. When x goes to negative infinity, y goes to zero, which makes it a horizontal asymptote, y equals zero. And in the case of y equals x cubed, when x goes to infinity, so does y. When x goes to negative infinity, so does y. So we have this limit equal to negative infinity and this limit equal to positive infinity. To find this limit, we are looking at the case that x is approaching infinity, and the process was to divide by highest degree term in the denominator. We divide everything by x squared. The numerator gives us three fractions, so does the denominator. At this point, you can see most everything becomes zero except 3 and 5. However, I want to show you the limit laws before we move on, which means we're going to take the limit for the top and separate it from the limit for the bottom. And the top has three terms. We make up three limits for the top, three limits for the bottom. And now we apply plugging in, and everything goes to zero with the exception of the first two. What I would except of course you don't have to take your time for those two steps that are really using what we call limit laws. You don't have to use that as far as I'm concerned, but you need to understand the process. And if you were to use even graphs, you see that we get to the same answer. 3/5 is the same as 0.6. When we take a limit as x goes to infinity, even negative infinity, when the limit of f of x, in this case, this is f of x, the function of interest, as x approaches negative infinity, we get to the same answer as the graph indicates. So infinite limits at infinity. Let's recap the concept with the following notation. The notation limit of f of x as x approaches infinity is infinity is used to indicate that the values of f of x become larger as x becomes larger. Similar meanings are attached to the following symbols. So take a look at the symbols. The limit of f of x as x approaches negative infinity is infinity. The limit of f of x as x approaches infinity is minus infinity. The limit of f of x as x approaches negative infinity is negative infinity. And in this case, the limit of f of x as x approaches infinity is infinity. All of them refer to what we learned in algebra as the end behavior. I hope you remember that. And in all of these cases, as far as the graph is concerned, the limit of f of x as x approaches infinity is infinity. For all of this, the difference would be somewhere faster than the others. And of course, again, reminding you about y equals x cubed. When x goes to infinity, so does y. Remember, the limit of f of x as x approaches infinity refers to the y coordinate. And as x goes to negative infinity, y goes to negative infinity. To find the limit, just plug in. For example, if the limit as x approaches any number is a number, you're done. If it's 0 over a number other than 0, the answer is 0 and you're done. If it's a number over 0, any number over 0, you have to pay attention to the sign, whether it becomes positive or negative infinity. We will look at that. However, most of the time in algebra, we deal with the following: 0 over 0, infinity over infinity, infinity minus infinity, which is known as indeterminate forms. And I always call them to what they really mean. We have to do more work. What do we mean by that? More work. We have to use our algebraic techniques to do the job. And that's really the key. If you look at these cases, you may see that if you plug in, you get infinity over infinity here, infinity over infinity here, infinity minus infinity. So what technique do we use? Rational expression, t is approaching infinity. We divide by the highest degree term in the denominator, which is t squared. That was the technique we used. We simplify each of them. We notice since t is going to infinity, this goes to 0, this goes to 0, this goes to 0, this goes to 0. So the numerator is 0, the bottom is 1, and the answer is therefore 0. rational expression, t goes to infinity. We divide by highest degree term in the denominator, namely t. We do that and we simplify each term. And at this point, we have to plug in. So we plug in infinity instead of t. This goes to zero, this goes to zero. And understand infinity plus two, it is still infinity. Divided by five, it is still infinity. Infinity divided by any number, no matter how large it is still infinity. Even if you divide it by 5 billion or 5,000, if you multiply it by 10, if you divide it by 10, makes no difference. In fact, or even if you take a square root of that. So just so you know, infinity divided by, let's say, 1,000, or infinity times 10, or infinity squared, or square root of infinity, or cube root of infinity, makes no difference. All of them, they result in infinity. If you look at part C, because of that reasoning, square root of x squared plus 1, that means square root of infinity squared plus 1, which is infinity, and infinity minus infinity is indeterminate. So the technique we use is that we multiply by the conjugate because their product, by the way, the conjugate for a minus b is a plus b. Their product is a squared minus b squared. We multiply by it, and to undo that, we divide by it. So it's important to know we can only multiply by one. That's why we divide and multiply by it. The denominator remains unchanged. We don't have to do anything. But the numerator becomes the following. A square root, we take it to the power of 2, minus x squared. And therefore, x squared plus 1 under the radical comes out. These two cancel each other. And now the denominator is infinity plus infinity, which is still infinity. And therefore, the answer is 0. Let's look at this example. We plug in, and to understand this, basically you're concerned with this part. Please understand that e to the power of minus t becomes e to the power of minus infinity, which is 1 over e to the power of infinity, which is 1 over infinity, and it's 0. That's something which has got to do with remembering. The negative exponential root. A to the power of minus m is 1 over a to the power of m. So 12 over 4, the final answer is 3. For part B, if you plug in, you get 5 plus infinity, 4 minus 3 times infinity, which is infinity over negative infinity. And it is indeterminate. What is the format we take care of the business? If you recall, for a rational expression, we divide it by the highest degree term in the denominator. This is not a rational expression because the top and the bottom are not polynomials. We divide by highest piece, which is e to the power of t. When we do that, it simplifies to the following. And 5 over e to the power of t, 4 over e to the power of t, both of them go to 0. We have positive 1 over negative 3, which is negative 1/3. For part C, if we plug in, we get negative minus infinity minus infinity, which is indeterminate. The algebraic technique is to factor. And so now, when we plug in, we get infinity times infinity minus 1, which is still infinity. Part D, we have a rational expression. X is approaching infinity. We divide by highest degree term in the denominator. So we divide everything by X. By the way, that one is infinity. I thought I gave you the answer. Sorry, class. This is infinity. And we're going to divide the part D, we divide everything by X, we end up with this. When we plug in, this is what's interesting. We get infinity plus 1 over 0 minus 1. What matters is that the top is infinity. The bottom is negative 1. Therefore, the answer is negative infinity. And that's the thing you want to be very careful of. Negative infinity. So you want to be careful with the sign. Okay. All right. Anybody feels like reading this question for us, please? Okay. The Pacific halibut fishery has been modeled by the equation B of t equals 8 times 10 to the power of 7 over 1 plus 3 e to the power of negative 0.71 t, where B of t is the biomass, the total mass of the members of the population in kilograms at time t. What is the limit? So let's take a limit. And again, notice the denominator as 1 plus 3 e to the power of negative 0.71 t. And this part becomes 1 over 1 over e to the power of 0.71 t. And when you replace the t with infinity, becomes 1 over infinity, which is 0. That's extremely important. And so the answer is 8 times 10 to the power of 7. Remember, this is 0. Kilograms of biomass. What is the significance of this limit? What does it mean? That means in a long run, the Pacific halibut biomass will be 8 times 10 to the power of 7 kilograms. That means 8 with 7 zeros. Kilograms. Let's look at the last question for this section. Anybody wants to read this question for us? A tank contains 5,000 liters of pure water. Brine that contains 30 grams of salt per liter of brine is being pumped into the tank at a rate of 25 liters per minute. show that the concentration of salt after 10 minutes in gallons per liter is B of T equals 30 T over 200 plus T. Please understand, they want us to show this, and this is an algebraic expression which has got nothing to do with the calculus yet. So to show that concentration of salt after 10 minutes, that means how much salt over how much liquid. That's the meaning of it, salt over liquid. That's what we are looking to find out. So I want to quickly put up a table to give you an idea how it's going to work out. And then I'm going to erase that because I need this space. So we have the amount of liquid, that's for the denominator, and we have the amount of salt. And the liquid starts with 5,000 liters, and then we add. So just to give you an idea, if we add just 1 liter, because 30 grams of salt per liter of brine. So if we add 1 liter, we are adding brine. That just adds 30 grams of salt. If we add 10 liters, it adds 10 times 30 grams. And we know that it's going to do 25 liters per minute. So if we do just 1 minute, that will add 25 liters of brine, which means 25 times 30 grams of salt is added. But we want to know what happens after 10 minutes. So instead of 1 minute, we have 10 minutes. So we have 25 times T liters of brine being added. This is the amount of brine. Therefore, it will add 25 T times 30 grams of salt. So the amount of brine is this, the amount of salt is this. So I hope everybody is clear as to how we arrive at it. I need this space. So we are adding after 10 minutes, 25 times 10 liters of brine. Each one has 30 grams of salt, so multiplied by 25T, which means the amount of salt is 25T times 30. The amount of liquid is the original 5,000 liters of pure water plus 25T liters of brine. Let's plug in. Notice the top, we can factor out the 25. The bottom, we can factor out the 25. And when we drop it, we get exactly what they gave us. So believe it or not, that's the proof. So far, we just did some algebra. Now the next part, what happens as T goes to infinity, it simply says find the limit. So we want to find the limit of this expression. Go ahead and find it. We want to find this limit. Anybody has the answer? All right, we want to find the limit, and we notice this is a rational expression. T is approaching infinity. We divide by highest degree term in the denominator, which is t. We simplify the top, we simplify the bottom. As you can see, when t goes to infinity, 200 over t goes to zero. And the answer is 30 divided by 1, or 30 grams per liter. And what does it mean? This is what I want to emphasize, the concept and the meaning of this. When we go back to the question, we have this much water. And the point is, that's a lot of water, 5,000 liters of pure water. But it doesn't matter how much you have. If you keep on adding brine indefinitely, this will take over so much so that for all practical purposes, all water goes away and we have pure brine with 30 grams of salt. See, we get the same answer, 30 grams of salt per liter of brine. That's exactly what we get, because the amount of pure water compared to the amount of brine that we are going to have won't be much for all practical purposes. It'll be zero, so it becomes pure brine instead.